the song everything.
And in the barber's chair this week, he writes massive tunes like Every Time You Go Away. He was mates with Marvin Gaye and the Temptations. He was in a chart-topping duo but no longer gets his oats. We know he's got soul. We're doing the dog with Daryl Hall.
Hi, Daryl.
Hey.
I have to say, I've done a lot of pop stars here in my time, and only, I would say, you and probably Brian Ferry are the only ones that really have great hair.
Good hair? Okay,
yeah.
Well, that's good to know.
You must look after it.
Actually, I don't really do too much to it.
Really?
No. I hardly ever put conditioner or any of that kind of thing, you know?
Don't say those sort of things.
It kind of grows.
So, the Silver Album that you did in 1980 had you and John in full makeup.
That was 75, by the way.
Was it 75?
Uh-huh.
Oh, God.
Way back.
It's got 1980 written on it. It must have been a reprint.
Yeah, it was.
Now, I know that you had a lot of flack at the time because everybody kind of thought you were gay and stuff like that.
Yeah.
How did you kind of live with that at the time?
Well, I think it was sort of living it down, to tell you the truth. I mean, I think when I look back on things that I've done, it's like I didn't pay enough attention to my, when you start out to pay attention to your image, and I didn't do that. I just let people do things to me.
Now, you've worked with some of the big soul greats, you know, like the Stylistics and stuff like that. I mean, have you seen a lot of racism in the music industry? Or does that not really occur?
I think to some degree it does, yeah. It's hard to say. I mean, when I grew up in Philadelphia, I was working with all those people, and it was a very integrated scene. I don't think anybody thought too much about it then. It seems like that now it seems to be getting worse in the States.
Really?
Yeah. I think it's sort of an unhealthy sign. I think that things seem to be separating more than ever in the States.
Like what?
I think a segregation on radio, a social segregation. I think the black people tend to be apart from the mainstream, whatever, you know, artistically. They're going for their own thing. I understand why, but it's an unhealthy thing. I see a lot of breakdown in people working together, you know, which is really ironic because there's so much black music on pop charts now, much more than there ever was.
A lot of respect for people like Marvin Gaye, and I know that you've, you know, reworked some of his songs as well.
Yeah.
How is it that so many of those kind of greats always kind of come to sort of untimely deaths all the time? I mean, I know obviously he was shot by his father, but so many always come to sticky ends.
Well, soul singers are strange people. I mean, you're living with your emotions and your nerves very close to the surface, and
did you know Marvin?
Yeah, I knew him, and I mean, I especially knew David Ruffett, Eddie Kendricks, and the rest of the Temptations, who were all part of that scene, you know. Uh-huh. I sort of started with them. And they also sort of met the same end. Three of the Temptations met really horrible ends. And I always say that soul singing is sort of crying in tune. You know, that's really sort of the definition. And it's not the blues, but there's a certain kind of sensitivity and
romanticism, maybe.
Yeah, poignance, all those things. I don't think you can lead a really carefree and happy, non-introspective life and sing soul. I think you have to have a little bit of darkness to yourself.
Well, a lot of your music has a great deal of kind of emotion and you know, romanticism. I mean, would you say that you're a romantic kind of guy?
Yeah.
Are you in love at the moment?
Good question.
Good question. Yeah. Kind of, huh?
Yeah, I'm just trying to stay happy, let's put it that way. Because I do have a dark side.
So you don't know whether or not you believe in love at first sight or not?
I believe in love at first sight. I don't know about second and third and all that kind of thing, you know.
People try. the song Every Time You Go Away is one of my personal favorites. Mm-hmm. And I remember when I saw you in concert in New York, mm-hmm. I kind of got the impression that you were really pissed off that Paul Young had got a cover version and got it to number one as well.
No way, man. I was really happy that Paul cut that song because it always sort of laid around on the B-side of the Voices album, and nobody really knew the song, and I always wanted to play it. I always liked that song a lot myself, and when Paul cut it, everybody, he did a good job with it, and it became a world hit, so now I can sing it, he can sing it, and everybody wins.
You didn't sing it before, when you were in London.
I know.
I was there, you didn't sing it there, you didn't have the courage of your convictions.
I didn't start singing it until it became a hit, that's the whole thing.
Have some of your experiences in life helped you, you know, in your songwriting? I mean, a couple have come to mind, you know, things like, you know, She's Gone and stuff like that. Were they truthful happening
She's
to you?
Gone was. She's Gone was a real...
She went.
Yeah, she went.
I read in the press that you have a son. Is that true or is that made up?
You know, somebody asked me that yesterday. No, I don't. No. Somebody said I had a 16-year-old son, which is absolutely not true.
It's obviously something your record company put out.
I don't know where it came from.
Almost. Maybe it was at the time in the 70s, you know, to kind of like...
Maybe I do and don't know about it. There you go.
So you don't have kids?
No, no kids.
You gonna have kids?
No. I don't know. It's hard to say. If I find the right person to have them with.
You don't know if you're with the right person now.
No, well, I don't think kids are in the cards with what I'm doing right now.
Let's meet a man with a name everybody knows and a